Now, let us prepare our hearts and minds for a time of meditation. I invite you to find a comfortable position in your seats. Close your eyes if you wish, and take a few deep breaths. Let go of any distractions or worries that may be on your mind.
God is here. God is now. God is all. God is the life within my heart. So I see and I feel and I know all is perfect. In my world, God is here, God is now, God is all, God is the life within my heart. So I see and I feel and I know all is perfect and right in my
So we breathe. Breathe, recognizing that this breath is that which is God breathing itself. That this divine thing called respiration, this divine inhale and exhale, is a spiritual lesson per se, where we are reminded of the reciprocity that God is. We are reminded that there is that which we receive and accept, and there is that which we let go of and release, and that both of these are part of the divine process. Both of these are representing that which God is, this divine yin yang, the give, the receive, the inhale, the exhale, the time to move and the time to sit still. That both of these are necessary for this thing called life to take place. This breath also anchors us right here and right now in this present moment, because as I always say, we cannot rebreathe yesterday's breath. We cannot pre-breathe tomorrow's breath. Nor can we save a breath for a rainy day. Only this inhale and this exhale, present, right here and right now. And so anytime during the day, we are able to pause and check in and allow this breath to remind us right here and right now, and nothing more. Right here and right now, and nothing more. The worries of tomorrow, right here and right now, and nothing more. The woulda, coulda, shouldas of yesterday, right here, right now, and nothing more. Breathe. Right here, right now. God is, and all is well, right here, right now. Breathe. We breathe. And just as there is no need to micromanage our breath, because we are able to go about our regularly scheduled programming on any given day, driving a car, going shopping, whatever it is we are doing, the breath is there whether we are aware of it or not. God is there whether we are aware or not. And so we are able at any time, any moment throughout the day to pause and check in. Let the breath be the reminder right here and right now and nothing more. It does not mean we don't plan for tomorrow and do our activities and speak to a therapist about things that happened in our past, but it means we recognize that this breath and this point of power right here and right now is where the healing occurs. Right here and right now is where we choose to actively embody that which we know God to be as us. And we understand that this little light of mine isn't a little light at all. This great light of mine, I must let it shine. And we breathe and shine that divine light. We breathe and recognize that, yes, there is peace on earth because it began with me. Breathe. Yes, there is peace on earth. Yes, there is love on earth. Yes, there is. Fill in the blank. And it began right here and right now in this breath. And so it is.
You can spend your whole life building something from nothing. One storm can come and blow it all away. Build it anyway. You can chase a dream. It seems so out of reach, and you know it might not ever come your way. Dream it anyway. God is great, but sometimes life ain't good, and when doesn't always turn out like I think it should, but I do it anyway. I do it anyway. This world's gone crazy, and it's hard to believe that tomorrow will be better than today. Believe it anyway. You can love someone with all your heart for all the right reasons, and in a moment they can choose to walk away. Love them anyway. God is great, but sometimes life ain't good. And when I pray, it doesn't always turn out like I think it should, but I do it anyway. I do it anyway. You can spin, you can sing a song that you believe in, and tomorrow they'll forget you ever sang. Sing it anyway.
The Music Ministry of David Trolley. Thank you, David. That was beautiful. Thank you. Well, I am excited to have our guest speaker this morning, Reverend Dr. Raymont Anderson, with us. I want you to know that I purposely scheduled myself to be the platform host this morning, so I would be here to hear this gentleman. And you know, I was, how am I going to introduce this guy? And I was reading his background, and I thought, well, that will take longer than the talk if I introduce him that way. My God. So read the e-news about Dr. Ray. It is fascinating. And thank you. But what my welcome or introduction to Ray this morning, what came to my mind was the power of power. Power. The power of power, the spoken word. That there's power behind our spoken word that we express in this human experience. The spoken word brings power to it. And having Ray, who's an ordained CSL minister here, is such an example of power to me, because as we come together in new thought and bring our spoken word to the rest of thought, there's power in that. And it's good for us to come together. And those of you who joined us for the Emma Curtis Hopkins book study, we all came from Emma. We all came from the truth. So it's great to have other truth students here from, I don't even want to say other denominations, because really we are New Thought. So welcome, New Thought Minister. Welcome, Reverend Dr. Raymont Anderson.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word is each of us incarnating right here and right now. Namaste and greetings. And thank you, beloved Unity of Davis. Thank you. It is great to be with you all once again. Are you ready for this today? Are you sure? In honor of Halloween, you know, you got to throw that in there. So, thank you, Reverend Richard. I appreciate you. I appreciate all that you're doing. I appreciate, you know, this is the first time we actually chatted, you know, the pre-service thing. And, you know, some of our colleagues, as you well know, are sort of what we would call uptight. And so in my, you know, being me, you were right there with me with the comedy and the laughter and that divine ha, 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 that ha, that holy activity of God. So thank you for how you show up. So Unity of Davis, today we are talking about this idea of living beyond the beyond. What does it mean to live the way of a trans-spiritual life? Breathe that in for a second. A trans-spiritual life. So, you know, in New Thought, we often talk about things like evolving consciousness and enlightenment and healing and transformation. And like we talk about a lot of this stuff very, 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 very often. And yet, in many ways, the way that we talk about it, we're barely scratching the surface, right? Like we use a lot of jargon in the way that we represent, in the way that we talk about this thing called God, Spirit, Source, abundance, etc. And we know that oftentimes it's jargon. You know, there, for example, if I were to ask you positive, is positive a good thing? Normally we would say, well, yeah, because we talk about the power of positive thinking. But is positive positive all the time? No. Because if someone tests positive for COVID, that's not the, well, them testing positive for COVID was negative. You wait, say what now? So a positive times a positive equals, but we understand for the sake of linguistic convenience, we understand. It's sort of like using spiritual shorthand. But our invitation today is to go beyond the spiritual shorthand, to go beyond the jargon, to step beyond our comfort zone, to go into that space where we not only practice, new thought, but we live it, move it, and have it as our way of being. When Yeshua said, "I and my Father are one," breathe that in, because he wasn't talking about simply practicing spirituality. He wasn't talking about practicing, you know, whatever. He was talking about embodying. Be ye therefore perfect, just as your, as he said, just as your Father who in heaven is perfect. Be it. He didn't say do this and do this. Well, first, if you attend this class that I'm teaching on Thursday night, and then you buy this book, and then you drink this certain soda, and then you do this and walk the labyrinth on Friday. And he didn't give a whole series of, you know, it was be it. So if we're going to go beyond the beyond, then let's have a sort of starting point for this whole idea. If I say he pointed to a spot beyond the trees, what is that beyond? The questions were well beyond the understandings of the average adult. What is that beyond? Well, beyond telling us that she was well educated, he had nothing to say about her. What is that beyond? See, like each time we use the word, we have an understanding that the word is sort of pointing to there's a boundary. There's a some point that is beyond this point here, something that is outside of the range of something except from, like we understand it in terms of that. But when it comes to this idea of being the divine, we sort of put a, well, it works when we're talking about this, but the moment we start talking about this part, woo, it's uncomfortable because that quote unquote humanness that we sort of quantify, our humanness pushes against the divinity. It's easy for us to accept, you know, as a human, I am flawed and I make mistakes. Ah, yes. Yeah. But the moment we start talking about being whole, perfect, and complete, even in the midst of a challenge, well, see, right there. See, it's like what David was singing about, right? You're talking about some do it anyway. Be whole, perfect, and complete anyway. Even in the midst of the health challenge, the financial challenge, the house, the hurricane, the politics, the whatever it is, even in the midst of it, be it anyway. Which means going beyond, there is this little nice and neat Tupperware container where I am human. And then there's this one over here where occasionally I will pop the lid every now and then for that fresh burp, boop. And then I close it again. And this is the one where my divinity is. No. Let's stop Tupperwaring our divinity. Let's get one plate that doesn't have the little sections for the corn and the peas and the carrots, and just one plate where everything is on as one meal. This idea of beyond, this idea of New Thought 4.0 is the idea of embracing the truth of our being, period. That there is no, there is no but, it's both and. That our humanity is our divinity. Not separate from it or different from it, but it's both and. That which God is, okay, so, you familiar with, there's this guy by the name of Meister Eckhart. You know, he's a mystic from way back yonder sometime, whatever. Anyhow, Meister Eckhart at one point said, between me and God, there is no between. Between me and God, there is no between. So what is he actually saying? That which God is, I am. We talk about God within New Thought. There is only one power and only one presence, God. That which is infinite goodness itself. And what it is, it must be incarnating as us. It's all there is, right? Like there isn't God and Reverend Ray, God and Reverend Richard, God and Sue. It's God as Sue, God as Reverend Richard, God as each and every one of us, because it's all there is. So once again, our invitation is step into that space where we acknowledge, because to step into that space where we acknowledge that, it means we have to also recognize our own beauty. To be able to say of yourself and about yourself, I am an amazing, intelligent, and beautiful divine incarnation of source, of spirit. And even when my check bounced, it does not detract from or take away from my divinity. There is no amount of, so I had food poisoning 3 days ago and I still got the diarrheas and somehow it makes me less holy. No, it does not. No matter what's going on in our physicality, we are a divine demonstration of oneness. Period. If you were planning a trip to say, let's say New York City, you're planning a trip to New York City and, you know, somehow you fall asleep. And when you wake up, Reverend Richard reminds you or lets you know, yeah, we've arrived. We're there. Well, if you're already there, where is there to go? If you're already divine, where is there to go? If you're already sacred, where is there to go? If you're already a divine incarnation of God, where is there to go? You're already there. In the words of the great guru Galinda, you had the power all along. And not even just you had, you are that power, and you have been, and you forever will be, whether in this incarnation or in the next iteration of life after life, and the next and the next and the next, for that which God is infinite, eternal, and ever expanding consciousness. And if that's what it is, and it's all that there is, then doesn't that mean it has to also be what we are? Like, it's like I often tell my fundamentalist Christian siblings, when they talk about, you know, we are made in the image and likeness of God. And I'm like, yeah, yes, exactly. Which means, just like our parents, we share the DNA of our parents. Well, that which God is, as the infinite creation itself, not even just creator, but creation itself, it is all of it and more. It is creator, creation as process, and the creation that comes from the process, all of it. Then we share the DNA of it. We share the divinely natural attributes of the all that is. But when we speak of ourselves, do we speak of ourselves as that power, with that power, or do we negate it? You know, when we talk about things like we are transforming, okay, so like there's the caterpillar, and we use the example caterpillar, metamorphosis, butterfly. But if it's all the same thing, then that which is butterfly is still there with that which is caterpillar. It's already there. It's not like the caterpillar's like, I'm going to cocoon, and it goes in, and it's like, I'm a unicorn. Wait, say what? Like, it's not like it's becoming something that completely is impossible for it to become. That which it is becoming, it is simply becoming more of what it already is. Because the thing that it is becoming has to already be right there where it is. So in this form that we are in, we call human. Yes, got that. But it has to be divine. If God is all there is, then even this human form and this flesh that is, here we go into paradox, and that flesh that is temporal and temporary and relative, subjective, it must be made of God's stuff. Every atom, every molecule, every quantum particle and wave, God. Every bone, every muscle, every sinew, every fiber, every tendon, every cartilage, God. Every optic nerve, every brain synapse, all of every blood vessel, God. There is nowhere in this thing called body where, you know, someone can go in and say, I found it. This is where God was not. There's not a spot where God is not. So it has to be all of this. Beyond the beyond is sitting in that space that says, I don't care for this feeling. Like I may have shared this with you before when I was diagnosed with prostate cancer. No, but I didn't want to hear that. I didn't. When they came in and said, yeah, that's what I, la, 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 like, I don't want to hear that. But beyond the beyond says, I understand that this body experiences, okay, but now what? Now, how do we, as the medical team and me, because I'm the patient, how do we optimize my health and well-being as a team? Now, what is mine to do as the individual? What is mine to do as part of the collective? How do I go beyond the diagnosis into the beyond of wholeness, perfection, and completeness? What is my invitation? How do I further nurture that and support that as the truth of my being? Breathe. So being a part of the LGBTQ community, you know, I know quite a few transgender individuals. And one of the things that, you know, often comes up is this idea of how many of them wish cisgender LGBTQ people or cisgender heterosexual people, like, that, stop referring to me as a woman trapped in a man's body or vice versa. There is no There's no one trapped in, as though there's an inside and an outside. There is simply me. So our invitation with this whole idea of trans-spiritual is, we, for once again, be with me for a second. We use it as linguistic convenience. God within. I got that. That's not the issue per se. Feeling like that's all that God is within, is where we bump up against the no trespassing sign, the boundary or the border. God is within and outside. God is with and God is as. Wherever we go, God is and all is well. So there is no simply inside or outside. God is all side. So trans-spiritual living is recognizing that that which God is, that which source is, that which spirit is, that which the infinite divine is right where I am, in me, with me, through me, as me. And I know that that is a hard pill for many of us to swallow, especially when we are facing challenging things. But we breathe and we ask ourselves, do I believe in what New Thought teaches? Do I believe in what Unity teaches? Do I believe it? Ask, sitting into that space of truly asking ourselves and exploring. Well, I believe this and I'm fine with that. But when it comes to this, perfect. Ask yourself those questions, because to go beyond the beyond is to ask questions, even when there may not be a clear answer for the question. It's being willing to ask anyway. As David said, pray anyway, serve anyway, love anyway, even when... and meditate anyway, and breathe anyway. So as we venture in, it's like we're at the swimming pool, and we're gonna take that one step into the pool and just test the waters. If I were to say, I'm gonna give you a math problem: 3 + 7 = Knowing math as well as we do, we know that there is one answer. 3 + 7 = there's an answer, 10. But what if we flip it and saw equals 10? How many different ways can we get to that 10? There's an infinite number of ways now that we can get to that, right? 1 + 9 = 10. 2 + 8 = 10. 5 × 2 = 10. There's an infinite number of ways that we can get to that. 20 - 10 = 10. So when we start at the end, knowing that that which God is, I must be, that wholeness, perfection, and completeness is what I am choosing to embody and how I am choosing to show up in my life. Start from the end. A world that works for all. Start at the end. As Reverend Richard talked about it in the beginning, there's this idea of our political leaders. Well, imagine for a moment that all of our political leaders knew who and what they truly are. Imagine what the world would be like if every political leader knew who and what they are. Imagine what the world could look like. Start there. I know it is challenging to start here with prostate cancer, diagnosis, pain, discomfort, surgery. Yes, because it is a real world right in your face thing. But the moment I am able to also see the end, I am able to see the "and so it is" and live from there, then things change. I'm sure we've all heard the phrase, representation matters. And if I were to ask you, well, what does that mean to you? Well, normally we reference it in terms of diversity and equity, but what if, imagine for a moment that this phrase was actually an invitation for us to show up more fully authentic, more fully transparent, more fully our divinely magnificent selves, allowing that representation to show up, showing up as a conscious representation of the divine, as the truth of our being. When love shows up and does what love does, what happens in the world? Breathe. And so lastly, living a trans-spiritual life beyond the beyond is one, knowing your worth, knowing your divine worthiness, no matter what, no matter your age, your height, your weight, your medical diagnosis, you are innately, divinely, you are worthy. It is also knowing that the power that you have and the power that you are afforded the opportunity of how you choose to steward it, to have a sort of divine dominion or sovereignty through the way that you use new thought and the principles of unity and all that you are learning in a life-affirming way to change, quote unquote, to embody, quote unquote, to live, move, and have your beingness individually and collectively, knowing that you are the infinite I am that is ever becoming and ever expressing itself more and more and more and more as you, moment by moment, breath by breath. There is nothing that can make you any less divine or any less God. You are it. Are we going to act like it? And so it is.